Welcome back. We're about to have our IAEL Masterclass. Our Masterclass is our classic session. It enables us to have a deep dive into a key issue in our industry. And this year, the topic is fair use, as we call it in the US, or fair dealing, or copyright exemptions in other countries. Throughout the history of our business, there's always been a balance under copyright between the rights of the owners and the rights of the users. But with the advent of digital services, and especially user-generated services, consumers have begun to expect to have much more ability to interact with content and to share it. And this has caused these concepts that we have had in our copyright law to be under great stress and review. And that's the topic of our masterclass today. We're lucky to have our IAEL member, Christine Lepera, here to moderate the masterclass. Christine is on the governing board of her firm, Mitchell, Silberberg, and Knupp in New York, and she's also co-chair of their Entertainment and IP Litigation Practice Group. Christine represents a lot of very well-known artists and companies, including Jay-Z, and has been involved in a lot of key compelling cases. So I am very pleased to introduce the moderator of this year's IAEL Masterclass, Christine Lepera.
Thank you, Jeff. Thank you. Big hug. Yeah. Okay. Hi, everyone. How are you all doing? So we're going to have, hopefully, an engaging panel today on the topic of fair use and related doctrines in the copyright space, US, EU, and to the extent of variance in the UK. I'd like to welcome to the stage the panel members. We have Brad Mullins, Alexander Ross, and everyone knows Massimo, who's the most brilliant one of them all. Okay. So first off, and I won't get into too much detail as an intro, but the point being we have varying doctrines in the US, EU, and to some extent the UK, with a global worldwide situation, both with digital platforms and just generally ascertaining in the courts what's a fair use, what's fair dealing, what's an exception, you know, is this something that can be done, what is fair to allow someone else to utilize a copyright to the exclusion and perhaps argument by the owner that this is not fair. How does that work? What is the analysis? So what we're going to do here today is we're going to take it in steps, because this is how a court would do it. First, look at the doctrine. So we're going to first take a section from each of the, as I said, US, EU, and then to the extent variation, UK. What is the actual doctrine, whether it's called fair use, fair dealing, copyright exemption or limitations, and analyze that specifically with reference to the statute or other applicable rules and regulations. Second to that, we are going to look at the application of that doctrine and how courts, in certain examples and precedents, determine whether or not the use is fair dealing, or an exception in the jurisdictions. The last thing that we're going to do, time permitting, is to talk about the broader issue that Jeff raised, which is, and with the new EU directive coming into play into a lot of argument and debate as to its validity, its application, what happens when you have mass content, when you have these large digital platforms where content is being constantly posted, uploaded, streamed, et cetera, and there's infringement claims on the content side and on the platform side. Are there burden-shifting mechanisms that are coming into place, and are they varying and different in the jurisdictions as to what to let in, what to let out, keep out, and how is this going to be impacted by the specifics of these substantive legal doctrines? Okay, so with that, let me actually, once again, this is the description of the panel, which is on the Midem program. I essentially provided this already in my summary, so we can just move past that. And again, we have Massimo Travostino, And Massimo, why don't you give just a 2-second introduction with respect to your storied career and the like, so I don't have to move from my iPad to my slide.
Right. It's very easy. I am a lawyer, partner at DGTB Legal in Italy, and I study music very much. So I'm very fond about these issues on copyright because I got a piano diploma at Conservatorio, and we have clients in all the fields of IP law, so not just copyright, but also trademarks and patent law.
And Alexander, if you would do the same.
Yes, hi. Luckily, I'm also a lawyer, which is useful, I guess. I'm a partner at a firm called Wiggin in the UK. We're a media, technology, and brands practice. That's what we focus on. I've been doing this for about 25 years now and advise clients right across the music industry.
And Brad, you're up next. And Brad's my partner, full disclosure. We work together in the MSK Entertainment Litigation Department.
Yes. No conflict there. I'm also a lawyer, not surprising. As Christine said, I'm a partner at Mitchell, Silberberg, and Knupp in our Los Angeles office. I focus on intellectual property and entertainment litigation with an emphasis on the music industry, but also in the video game industries and film and television as well.
Okay, so moving along here, we only have an hour, so I'm going to try to keep this moving. Let us discuss first, as I said in my intro, the basic doctrines. Brad, can you give us a recap of how U.S. courts look at the issue of fair use based on what statutory principle?
Yeah, in the U.S., fair use is actually a statutory construction. It's in the 17 U.S.C. section 107 of the United States Code. It basically sets out the principles of fair use, which were established at common law. The preamble states that fair use copyrighted work can be used for purposes of criticism, comment, news reporting, teaching, scholarship, or research, but that is not an exhaustive list. Frankly, even those uses are not always a fair use. Instead, the courts look to a four-factor test.
Is this the four-factor test?
That would be correct. So there are four factors the courts go through, and it's a case-by-case basis. The first factor is the purpose and character of the use, and what this really looks to, the main thing is what courts call whether the use is transformative, and that means whether the use adds something new with a further purpose or different character, altering the first with new expression, meaning, or message. So basically, whether it actually changes the work or supersedes the work instead of just reusing it wholesale. Another element of this first factor is whether the use is commercial or non-commercial. Non-commercial uses tend to weigh in favor of fair use, commercial in favor of not fair use, but that doesn't tend to be a big distinction. Even commercial uses can be fair. The second factor is the nature of the original work, which usually is not an important factor in this analysis. It looks to whether the work is creative or more factual, but usually since we're dealing with copyrighted works, they tend to be on the creative side. The only place this really comes into play is with photographs, for example. If something was just a photograph taken on a street of an event happening, that tends to be more factual versus, you know, a staged photograph in a portrait studio would be on the more creative spectrum. The third factor is the amount and substantiality of the portion taken, which looks to how much of the work did you use in creating the new work. There's, again, no rules here. You can sometimes use the entire work. You can sometimes use a bit of the work. It looks at how important was the piece you took and how necessary was it for you to take that piece. And the last factor, which is the effect of the use on the market, looks to whether allowing the type of uses on a large scale, so permitting these sorts of uses as fair use all the time, would that take away a market that the copyright owner should normally have?
Okay. Are these factors exclusive?
They are not. Courts can also look at other things. For example, they can look to the intent of the secondary user. So they look if there's bad faith. If the user really, there's evidence that they stole it intending to really trade off or market on the original product, that might be a factor that comes into play.
Okay. And so what you're really saying is it's a case-by-case, fact-by-fact.
Correct.
Analysis in every situation is different, right?
Correct. That's one of the fun parts of being a U.S. litigator in fair use is there really are no hard and fast rules. Every case is different. You can never really know how a case is going to turn out. But there are some myths that come into play here.
Okay, what are they?
Yeah, so for example, people think, okay, I just used a few seconds of a clip, then so that's going to be fair. That's not true. Even a few seconds can be not a fair use. So that's never look at just the duration. Second, if you're giving away for free, you're not charging anything. Again, that's just one factor. Whether you're using it for yourself, again, not always a fair use. Some people think, well, I'm using this in a way that it's giving you free publicity, so you should be happy. That's not going to make it a fair use. And the last one is if it's funny. Sometimes funny works can be a fair use in the parody context, but often not. Like satirical works, which you're not really commenting on the original, are less likely to be a fair use.
So essentially, even though some people think, oh, there's some hard and fast rules. If I just use a small amount, I can, you know, establish that it's fair use, or you know, if I don't make any money off of it. None of these things are going to be black and white rules. They will all be considered, because even these myths can factor into the four factors.
Exactly.
Okay. So now let's move to the EU. And Massimo, why don't you give us the overview of the copyright exceptions and limitations in the EU with respect to the limitations on the copyright owner's rights to exploit.
Yeah, thank you, Christine. Just to begin to indicate the completely different environment where exceptional limitations to copyright are applied in the EU, I would like to begin with the words of the Advocate General Spooner in a pending case about exceptional limitations, who says that about exceptional limitations, U.S. law is a radically different legal environment to that of continental Europe. And therefore, he says that the reasoning of the U.S. courts cannot therefore be applied to EU law. Why? The main exceptions and limitations are contained in the Directive 2001/29 on the harmonization of copyright and relative rights in the information society, as well as in the directive on rental rights and lending rights. And a few words on the preamble of the directives are very telling about the purpose and how the directive is concerned about the exceptions. Just a few words taking into account, the directive takes into account, yeah, in the back, the different legal traditions in member states. So you understand that even the beginning of the approach of the legislature is difficult because it has to take into account the 28 different states' legal tradition. Of course, aiming to ensure a functioning of the internal market, which is not easy if you want to take into account all the different legal traditions. And the directive goes on saying that, of course, you have to comply with international obligations, which is also applicable, of course, to U.S. fair use. And the main one is the three-step test, which you know for sure. We have it stated in Berne Convention, TRIPS, Directive 2001, and Directive 2006. And basically, it's based on the three conditions, cumulative conditions, which have to be met by any exceptional limitation application, which are that such exceptions must concern certain special cases, so it's an exception. They must not conflict with normal exploitation on the work, and they do not have to unreasonably prejudice the legitimate interest of the author. And this is applicable to any exception.
So these are somewhat more subjective,
sure,
as well, and therefore can have different applications depending on which territory, which judge, what case. So it is still going to come down somewhat to case by case, yes?
Yes, okay. It is like that. And the consequence is that our directive has only one compulsory exception, which is a rather technical exception that concerns the reproduction, which are temporary, transient, incidental to the exploitation, legitimate exploitation of the works. So it's not really a true substantial exception. All the other exceptions stated in the directive are optional for the member states. So if we go to the other slides, we see a list of the main exceptions with evidence, the main exceptions which are interesting for our business, for music law and audiovisual products, which is private copy on any kind of medium, the ephemeral recordings for broadcasting organizations in providing those services,
the illustrations for teaching or scientific research, the information exception on news and information purpose, the quotation exception for criticism and review, and the use for purpose of caricature, parody, or pastiche, and the incidental inclusion in other works. Those are the main optional exceptions which can be applied in the legislation of each EU member state.
And that's why they're underlined here. Yeah? So that's to emphasize that these are the primary exceptions that you see in the various territories. Now, is it an exhaustive list?
Yes, it okay. is an exhaustive list. This is the first, very important not to do that. Then it's optional, as we were saying. Member states may decide to apply one, more than one, all or nothing. And we have also to take into account that the exceptions are also applicable together with technological protection measures applied to the files and material supports where the works are fixed. So there must be also a balance between the application of a technological protection measure and the availability of those exceptions. This leads to a consequence, which you see visually in this yeah. slide.
Explain this to the audience, yeah.
Yeah, this is the field where the exceptions are applied in all the 28 member states, still 28 member states. So you see it's a spotted field, green and red fields. If you take one example, the exception of caricature, parody, or pastiche, we have seven member states who did not provide the exception, or they provided only in part. So the consequences may be very, very, very important to that, because a work which is protected by an exception in one member state cannot be maybe used or circulated or distributed in another member state where the exception doesn't work.
So global exploitation is an issue, not just US versus EU and all other places in the world, but within the EU itself.
That's right.
That's the takeaway.
And okay. we have even more, because under EU case law, these exceptions have to be applied by interpreting them strictly. Not only they are exhaustive, not only they are optional, but if they exist, they have to be strictly interpreted. So the EU courts, the European Court of Justice, and the national courts need further flexibility to apply these exceptions, also to try to harmonize the rules. And where do they find this flexibility? Outside the EU law. So they find this flexibility in applying the fundamental charters of human rights, for example, freedom of information, freedom of arts, because these are principles are above, hierarchically speaking, are above the EU law, and EU law must comply with that. So this is a way of trying to harmonize and extend the application of exception, which are not such strictly indicated by the EU directives.
And, right. Yeah. It's a bit of a conflict then. Yeah. Strict interpretation, flexibility, strict interpretation. So you can see where it's very commonly known, and many of the cases in the US say it, I'm certain in the EU cases as well, that these doctrines are slippery. They're extremely complicated. Their judges have a very subjective, difficult time, coming to a conclusion, and I guess at the end of the day, what they're really trying to do is be fair. Okay, we've sort of touched on this need for harmonization, etc. So now I think let's turn to you, Alexander, and why don't you give us, your assessment of both the EU topic that we just discussed, the EU version of exceptions, and anything that the UK adds to it or supplements it in variation.
Okay. So in the UK, we have what we call fair dealing, which is effectively a translation of the US concept of fair use. It's a common law doctrine, but unlike in the US, it hasn't got any statutory a statutory incarnation, it remains a common law doctrine and therefore subject to development and interpretation by the courts. And here are some of the statements made in some of the leading cases on fair dealing by judges who found themselves wrestling with, at some point, an elusive concept. You can see the judge was probably having difficulty there, arriving at a decision. A question of degree, clearly, as a general principle. And then, perhaps more specifically, a question of fact, both fact and impression. And of course, that is the impression of a judge on a Wednesday afternoon. So there is the opportunity and the possibility of varying decisions being made. And the concept of fair dealing is very narrowly construed so as to protect the rights owner.
Again, the balance. But this balance that is, again, on this slippery slope of how do you actually determine when it is fair. Now, are there additional statutory exceptions?
So we are in the UK still, for the moment, in the European Union. Therefore, we are bound by those exhaustive list of exceptions that Massimo described. We have, in the UK, implemented most of them. We'll come on to the exception for the moment, as indeed have most member states, for that matter. And these are the exceptions that we have, which are statutory exceptions, which are also, in which there is also a requirement for fair dealing. So it's not just an exception, but the fair dealing obligation is also applied. And you can see the list there.
And how is the fair dealing exception applied?
We'll come on to that. If you just quickly do the previous slide.
And then I'm sorry.
Just.
Yep.
So just to say, as I said, we have implemented almost all the exceptions in Article 5 of the 2001 Copyright Directive, with the notable exception, as I'm sure all of you know, of the private copying exception. And we've never had a, well, no, I lie, we have briefly had a private copying exception. As a result of a government recommendation or recommendation to the UK government, the government introduced a private copying exception in 2014, while at the same time deciding that there was no need for a compensation scheme as a result of the private copying regime. And the music industry got together, power to the music industry, and went for judicial review, the result of which the legislation was found to be effectively void, because the government had not gone through the appropriate process and had not decided whether or not that lack of compensation was necessary or was appropriate. So a year later, after being introduced, the legislation was quashed, in our word. So we no longer have a private copying exception, with this single legacy exception that you are allowed to copy TV programs from a broadcast for time shifting. In other words, to watch them at a later time. Interestingly, there's no requirement that you delete them after you've watched them. So you could actually build up an entire library.
It's sort of an odd exception, or to exclude this.
So just to look in the next slide, here are our factors. When a judge and a court is looking at whether or not the dealing is fair, they effectively look at three principal factors. Does the dealing commercially compete? And that factor has been said to be, by a number of decisions, by far and away the most important question. Is it trespassing on the rights, the commercial rights of the copyright owner or owners? Has the work already been published? If it hasn't, much more likely to be unfair. How much of the work's been used? Again, obviously, very similar to the US concept. Although I think, as we'll see from the parody exception, I think that might be difficult to apply as a test when, to parody a work, you are more than likely going to have to take the key element of it, otherwise it won't be recognisable. So I'm not sure how we apply that to the new parody exception. And the course also asks itself this general question: would a fair-minded and honest person deal like this? Which I think is a useful test, really, if we imagine that, you know, epitomal fair-minded and honest person.
So there is some overlap with the US four-factor test, but the largest missing component here that we have is the issue of the transformative use.
Yes, we don't have that concept.
Is that Okay, and so do you want to just briefly
And then just
this?
Quickly, as a result of various case law, particularly European case law, judges in fair dealing cases are now considering these two additional elements over and above the factors, the fact that one must allow for freedom of expression, that arose out of the Deckman case, which we'll hopefully look at briefly later, and there remains a public interest test, where there is a public interest, which of course isn't the same as what the public is interested in, mm-hmm. which is another matter, but a general public interest test, particularly for printed fair use.
Thank you. So now we've gone through essentially the basic doctrines, which we can see are not all in sync. There's some overlap. There's a lot of inherent flexibility in some, stated flexibility in others, yet with a strict interpretation. So let's look and see how there's actually the application of these doctrines in certain precedents. And we'll start with the U.S. and with its seminal case, Campbell versus Acuff Rose, and I'll turn it over to Brad to explain what that case stands for.
Yeah, within the U.S., fair use has actually played a pretty prominent role in the music industry, and really first started with this case, Campbell versus Acuff Rose, which is in 1994, and it went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, and it dealt with a parody of the song Pretty Women. And the second song was really a parody. It was commenting on the original, and that's what led the court to really create this idea of transformative use. We're not going to play these songs just for the interest of time, but we're going to move to present day, where we're seeing this applied still in cases in the past couple years.
But I do want to note, just for this purpose of the next round of cases, if you look very carefully at that definition, there's nothing in there that says it has to be a parody or a criticism or a commentary. The restrictions that, again, remember that little slide with the stop sign with the slash through it? It's a misnomer to say that those are the only changing in expression types of transformative use. The keywords, new, message, expression, or meaning.
Yeah, I'm correct. And we'll see that in some of these new cases.
Okay. And the first of which is?
So one of our recent cases was called Oywol versus Aura. It was a case out of New York. The plaintiffs were the founding members of a spoken word group called The Last Poets. And back in the 60s, they had recorded a spoken word album. One of the recordings was called When the Revolution Comes. And it was a spoken word piece about preparing for a racial revolution. And we can play the clip.
Okay, can we play the clip?
And straighten heads gonna be trying to wear afros when the revolution comes. When the revolution comes. When the revolution comes.
When the revolution comes.
But until then, you know and I know niggas will party and bullshit and party and bullshit and party and bullshit and party.
Okay, I think we get it. Okay. Next, let's hear the songs at issue.
Well, just real quick. Okay. So, about that lyric, the plaintiffs had actually testified about what that lyric meant, and they said the sole purpose of that lyric was to challenge and encourage people to not waste time with party and bullshit, but to move forward towards success. So then, in subsequent years, we actually had two songs coming out that were alleged to be infringing. So the next slide.
Okay.
Want to play the first clip?
Can we play the first clip, please?
Carry on, and it's on, and I'm gone.
Okay. We can stop. Thank you.
And that song you might recommend.
It's the second one. Okay, great. Thank you so much. Terrific. Okay.
So you'll probably recognize which part of the songs were alleged to be similar.
Yeah. Do we have to sing it again or rap it again? I can do it in harmony with these guys. Yeah. We've been practicing. Seriously.
So, but I mean, it's interesting that these plaintiffs sued both these songs in the same lawsuit. They're quite different songs. Obviously, the first one, Notorious B.I.G., song's called Party and Bullshit. Second song was Rita Ora, a song called How We Do Party. But basically, the plaintiffs actually alleged that these two songs contravene the original purpose of the work, which was to discourage people from partaking in party and bullshit, whereas both of these songs were really celebrating that as something. So the court went through the fair use factors, but the big factor here was the first factor, which was whether it's transformative. And as Christine mentioned, the issue is not whether it's commenting on the original work. It doesn't matter if anyone even knew about the original work at all. It's really whether the purpose, the message, was different. And the court has an easy time finding that the message of the new songs was to glorify partying and bullshit, whereas the original song was to condemn it. So the court found pretty easily that that was a direct transformation.
Okay. So again, buzzwords, new meaning, message, and expression of the content that is used, not the overall setting in which that content appears. So the actual transformation is in that used content.
Correct.
Okay, here's one that may have a different outcome.
Yes, so here we have a second song, this second case. This one's out of Louisiana. It's the estate of Anthony Barr versus Carter, as in Beyonce Knowles Carter. We can play these first two clips.
Play, thanks.
I'm back. But the subject I want to talk about today, hoes, is what happened at the New Orleans. You know, because bitch, see, everybody have their own side of the bed. And I let these hoes know, bitch, you know, because I, you know, somebody raised all my videos, bitch, I'm back.
Yeah.
By popular demand. And behind the camera is my messy hoe rolling.
So that gentleman is a man named Anthony Barr, also known as Messy Maya. He was a self-professed local New Orleans celebrity, had a pretty big YouTube following. He was actually tragically killed in 2010. But a few years later, Beyonce came out with an album called Lemonade and a song called Formation. If we move to the next slide.
Oh, next slide. Sorry. No clip on that, just slide.
Yeah, then we'll play this clip, which is the music video for Formation.
Okay. Then they have to do that. You guys have to do that.
What happened at the New Orleans? Bitch, I'm back. I'm popular the man.
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay.
So again, as you may recognize where the lawsuit came from, two of those clips were taken from Mr. Barr's videos and used in this Formation video. And his estate sued, saying this was infringement. So the court again went through the fair use factors, and again, a big issue was the first factor. And so it was looking to see whether the message of these works was different. The defendants in the case argued that the original works were just these stream of consciousness, spoken videos, just he was talking to a video camera, whereas they were trying to use the clips to really set the tone for this New Orleans-based video, New Orleans-based album. But the court found, well, really, they were just using these clips to set the New Orleans tone. They were using a New Orleans performer to set a New Orleans tone. That, to the court, was the same message. So the court found that the plaintiffs could proceed with their lawsuit and that the fair use defense could not be established.
Okay. And again, relying very heavily on that first transformative factor, not to the exclusion of the other three of the four factors test, but it is a very prominent one in all of the U.S. decisions. And so now we have our final slide on U.S. cases. Brad, you wanted to give a short description of this?
Yes, so this is another case. This case involved another spoken word piece called Jimmy Smith Rap. It was a spoken word recording about the process of recording a jazz album.
Okay. And in full disclosure, this is one of my cases where we represent Drake and the defense in connection with the use of the sample, which was licensed. The claim came by the estate of Smith that the spoken word portion of the licensed recorded sample was infringed. We won summary judgment on the ground of fair use by virtue of the transformative changes that were made to that spoken word, and we have those clips here. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Can you play?
Oh, back one slide for
back
that.
One slide.
Yeah, this is the original work.
Oh. Okay, I'm going. It moves fast. There we
like
go.
Back in the old days, you know, years ago, they had the A&R man to tell you what to play, how to play it, you know, whether it was disco or rock. But we just told Bruce that we want a straight-ahead jazz album, so we got all the fellas together. Grady Tate, Ron Carter, George Benson, Stanley Turrentine. Stanley was coming off of a cool jazz festival. Ron was coming off a cool jazz festival. And we just went to the studio and we did it. We had champagne in the studio, of course, you know, compliments of the company. And we just laid back and did it. Also, Grady Tate's wife brought down some home-cooked chicken. And we just laid back and we just chopping on chicken and having a ball. Jazz is the only real music that's going to last. All that other bullshit is here today and gone tomorrow. Okay. But jazz was, is, and always will be.
Can move on to the next.
We may not do this recording.
You can move on to the next.
We may not get with the fellas again. George.
Yeah, and then the next clip, you'll hear the second work, which was...
Which didn't take the entirety of all of those spoken words. It was a condensed and altered version, but then you'll hear the prominent transformative change.
Move to the next slide.
We'll move to the next clip. Oh, we have to move, yeah, okay. And now you can play that. Thank you.
Good God Almighty, like back in the old days. You know, years ago, they had the A&R men to tell you what to play, how to play it, you know, whether it's disco or rock. But we just went to the studio and we did it. We had champagne in the studio, of course, you know, compliments of the company, and we just laid back and did it. So we hope you enjoy listening to this album half as much as we enjoy playing it for you, because we had a ball. Only real music's gonna last. All that other bullshit is here today and gone tomorrow.
Okay. You can stop, thank you. Okay. Go ahead.
Well, so if you'll notice, as Christine mentioned, not all of the lyrics were taken, and there was one.
And they're not lyrics, they're just spoken words.
Yeah, spoken words, correct. And then there was one prominent change, which was the original work said that jazz is the only real music that is going to last. In Drake's song, that was just changed to real music is going to last.
Only real music is going to last. And, you know, you can read the decision, but it's key. The key point was that there's a very big... there was a clear issue of superiority in the jazz community versus in the hip-hop community, and how there's a clear message here that their music, the hip-hop message, in this culture is equivalent to any other kind of real music. That's the message. Okay, so let's move on now to one last quick one. Bradley, you have 1 minute.
Yeah, this is one real quick one just to show you how fair use plays out outside of the creation of music, which this is in the technological world. This is a case, Capitol Records versus Redigi. Redigi created a service that allowed people to resell the digital copies of songs. So songs they had bought in iTunes, they could then sell on an open marketplace. Redigi had said that was a fair use because it was changing how the songs were sold. It was giving a new purpose to being able to sell the songs. The court rejected that, saying, really, no, you're just doing the same things that iTunes does, which is exactly what record labels do. So by doing the exact same market, you're not changing anything. So that was found not to be fair use.
So the technological issue of a new meaning and message was not found here. You know, there's a content transformative, then there's a technological transformative. It doesn't have to be, you know, one or the other. And in this case, the technological transformation failed. Okay, let's turn to the UK and let's go through some examples there of the application of the fair dealing and or exception limitations in certain cases.
Okay, so just remember that the essential difference between sort of our concept of fair dealing and fair use is that there's no fair dealing per se in the United Kingdom. It has to fall into one of the Article 5 copyright exceptions. So fair dealing is like a test when you apply the exception. So first case, actually I was looking for music cases, and surprisingly perhaps, there really aren't any music cases in the UK relating to fair dealing of any interest, if at all. So here are cases which don't relate to music, but to give you an idea of how the courts have gone, first of all, there was a documentary about A Clockwork Orange, and they put 12 different clips in the documentary, 8% total, that was the total of the whole film that was taken, put in the documentary. That was deemed to be fair on the basis that the documentary was a critique of the film. So it fell under the basis of criticism and review. Proceben was a claim for fair dealing by way of news reporting. So there were 30-second clips from Proceben's film of a woman called Mandy Allwood who had 8 babies at once, which is quite extraordinary. And the question there was the dealing fair? It was deemed to be fair. But in that case, particularly because they had included ProSiebens' logo at the top of the screen and hadn't erased it. There was a recent case where the side of the day before Princess of Wales and Dodi Fayed died, they were briefly in a lift in a building in London, and for some reason a newspaper decided to print a picture of them, a still from the video camera, to show that they had been there, and they'd illegally obtained the picture, and the court decided not the fact that the image had been illegally obtained really meant the dealing was not fair, but it was also unnecessary to show the picture. They could simply have said a camera caught them in that place. And then finally, a company called TicStack, using, again, clips of sports events in apps, claiming that that was fair dealing on the basis of news reporting, and the court said, no, it's not. Those clips are there for the intrinsic value that they have, and that's why you're using them, and that dealing is therefore trespassing on the commercial rights of the author and copyright owner. Not fair.
Okay. And we have another case, Padawan.
So I'm just going to do a couple of then European cases. This, the Padawan case, was the case which determined the basis on which the private copy levies should be administered and applied in the European Union. So Padawan made effectively blank recording media. Sagai said, you know, we're going to levy a charge on your blank recording media. So the court. Padawan obviously challenged that, and the court said, well, the concept of fair compensation is an autonomous concept throughout the European Union. The basis on which the private copy must be judged is what is the harm to the copyright owner. And finally, they said there is a link required. So you can't just indiscriminately apply a private copy levy to every single type of device. You must actually decide whether or not that device is capable of copying copyright works. And the question was the Spanish law itself therefore unlawful? And the European court sent it back to the Spanish courts to decide that for themselves, as they should have done. And then the Decmin case, which I'm sure you all know, which was, and it's interesting, it was a grand chamber case, so literally they all went in there, 13 judges, very important. And as this was usage, you can see the original on the left-hand side, 1961, sort of children's cartoon series, and the, what I guess you guys would call the transformative use on the right-hand side, the mayor of Ghent in Belgium distributing freely money to persons who are, well, obviously, you know, in foreign, that's the point of the jibe, possibly Muslim, but certainly not originally Belgian, I guess. And the this was a use by this guy called Decmin, who was a member of a far-right party in Belgium, and he claimed the use was parody. So the Grand Chamber got together to decide what's obviously a very important case, setting the parameters for parody in the European Union. Again, parody must have an autonomous meaning, so we get harmonisation across the Union. And here are the important bits. So the parody must evoke the existing work while being noticeably different, which presumably isn't difficult to achieve. The interesting one, though, it must be an expression of humour or mockery. And of course, we all had a lovely time, didn't we, after this case was decided, imagining judges sitting there on the bench deciding whether or not the parody was funny or not, and whose view of whether it's funny was the relevant one. But I guess the or there is apparently, so it is relevant, so it could be simply mockery without being funny. And then the fair balance test, which is a common test for many European decisions, many European courts, is the fair balance between the interests of the rights owners on the one hand, under the Copyright Directive, and on the other hand, the rights of freedom of expression of the likes of Mr. Decmin. And again, it was for national courts to decide whether in this case the use fell under the exception.
And now, Massimo, you're going to talk a bit about another case. Craftwork?
Yes, just a few words on a pending case currently in front of the European Court of Justice, because it's a very telling on how the European judges currently apply the exceptions and limitations to copyright. It's a Kraftwerk case. We heard about that also this morning from Ralph Kitzberger. But we are very interested in that because of the exception limitations now, because the case concerns a song, Nur Mir, where 2 seconds of another song of the famous group Kraftwerk were taken and used as a continuous loop in the background, as a rhythm, basic, and rhythmic base of the song. And so after various things in front of the German courts, the German courts brought the issue against the European Court of Justice. And it's very interesting how the Advocate General Spooner addressed the issue. He says, this is a case, debate, in which postmodern artistic freedom is set up against good old property rights. So, and this gives the mood where the issue is set up by the Advocate General. We know the opinion of the Advocate General on the case. We still do not know which will be the final judgment. But from the application of our directives, it is clear that if we talk about sampling, which is the case at issue, and if we try to apply the exceptional limitation that this case to see if the sampling was allowed, was legal, of course the result under the current European legislation is negative. And the opinion of the Advocate General, even if there are some different diverging opinions of the national governments, is negative on the fact that even a short snatch excerpt of a song of 2 seconds may be used to be a basis of a new song. The Advocate General also talks about the application in the US of the minimis thresholds, which is we know a collateral concept to fair use.
So you're saying that there is no de minimis allowed.
He says that in the US, maybe you should talk about and try to apply the minimis thresholds. In the EU, there is no way we are going to talk about that, because the phonogram rights are not influenced about the creativity of the part of the recording which is taken to build the new work, because the phonogram rights are based on the economic effort, on the economic investment, and have nothing to do with creativity. So he's even saying that the neighboring rights of the producer is even stronger than the rights of the author.
Interesting. And in the U.S., there's varying, courts and circuits. Some will, use the de minimis defense. It's not fair use, but it's de minimis defense if it's a very short snippet of a sound recording, and others won't. So there's a variance there in our jurisprudence. Okay.
Yes, and
you said this already, right?
Yeah. There are a couple of other issues deferred to the European Court of Justice, which, of course, the Advocate General gave his opinion, and it was negative for both of them. The first one is pretty much obvious. If an independent work created in the free use of its phonogram may be exploited without the phonogram producer's consent, we're not talking about transformation, as we were saying and hearing in the U.S. cases, but a derivative work. So it's pretty obvious that the national provisions which could allow this kind of activity are not consistent with the European directives. And then, which is the extent of the quotation exception, and which the Advocate General is very, very strict in interpreting this kind of exception, if the exception is provided in the member state legislation, because as we told before, the quotation exception and the criticism review exceptions are not compulsory exceptions in the
Optional.
EU member states.
Yes. Optional. Okay, so we have now had a very, I'll call it, micro view of how, you know, each doctrine, each territory, different, applied, potentially different. You know, there's a, you know, these are one work against another work. Potentially it's a technological platform like in Redigi where there's a an innovation that's being analyzed under fair use. But can you imagine looking at it from a macro perspective when it comes to assessing, you know, when there's a mass digital platform with literally, you know, billions of potential works going in, potentially not supposed to be going in, and those that need to go in because they really fall within the parameters of these exceptions. And one of the most interesting things that's happened and that's created great debate and controversy is the new copyright directive, which Massimo will speak to, because it's fascinating when you look at it from the micro to the macro, and you can only imagine, you know, if you have to have a real fair use analysis or a fair dealing analysis or an exception analysis for every single work, how is that done on a mass platform, and who has to do it, if anyone? So let's speak to this.
Yeah, sure. Just to launch a discussion, at least just a few hints about what the new copyright directive is saying on this specific topic, exceptions and limitations, because the issues that we were talking about, of course, have been tried to be addressed by the new copyright directive in order to create a more comprehensive, advanced, and harmonized framework also in exceptions and limitation in the European Union. And then we have some principles in order to allow more cross-border and online access for citizens and businesses to copyright protected content, to allow the application of the human rights, freedom of expression, and on the arts. And this is leading to some new exceptions and limitations in all the member states. We can skip these two slides, and the main exceptions and limitations, the new main exceptions and limitations concern the text and data mining activities, the digital and cross-border teaching activities, the out-of-commerce works, which is could be very relevant, more than probably the orphan works for which we had a directive some years ago, and then more relevant for our issues, it are the provisions on exceptions and limitation in Article 17, which is the article concerning the online content sharing providers, the platforms. There are two basic issues in Article 17 which are addressed. First of all, for five times, Article 17 mentions the application of exceptions and limitations, which is really a sign of how the legislator was trying to cope with this issue, which was a really burning issue. And there are two main points that Article 17 addresses to that. First of all, Article 17 provides that the exception limitation concerning quotation, criticism review, as well as caricature, parody, or pastiche are compulsory in the for the online platform content sharing providers. So we are transforming an optional exception, two optional exceptions under Article 5, at least for this kind of activities for online content sharing platforms, in compulsory exceptions. Just read the text of the of point 7 of Article 17. Member states shall ensure that users in each member state are able to rely on any on this exceptional limitation on quotation, criticism, review, purpose of caricature, parody, or pastiche. So the first question and issue that comes to our mind is if this exception becomes compulsory only on the online content platform activities, or for every kind of activity, because otherwise there should be the article says that it's compulsory for this kind of activities, but otherwise there would not be any base to discriminate situations which are happening outside of the platforms.
And so, how does that get determined, whether or not it falls within these, as we've seen, somewhat subjective, somewhat flexible, even in your doctrines? How does that get determined then under this? And who has to determine it?
And sorry, just the second, just to close, the second point is that when content sharing platforms are going to provide with the adequate means to make the best effort to prevent the upload of copyrighted work, they have to ensure, in any case, that exceptions and limitations are respected. So to ensure that the upload and access of works which are covered by exceptional limitations is not limited by this kind of means. So the second issue is how we can reconcile the use of these means, the protection of copyright, with the exceptions and limitations.
Exceptions. Right. So we've all been discussing this whole panel about this balance and this need for determining whether or not something is a fair use or fair dealing or an exception. And we've also been examining how complex it can be, how lengthy the process of a litigation can potentially be to assess that, and how you can get different results depending on the jurisdiction, et cetera. So when you have a mass platform, how is this going to be determined? How could it be determined? Is this something that has been a great point of controversy concerning this new directive? Do you want to speak to it, Alexander, a bit?
In my view, like all European legislation, of course, is a compromise and often ends up being a very difficult compromise to understand and sometimes contradictory. But here we've arrived at a piece of legislation where there's been heavy-duty lobbying from all sides, from all interested parties, but particularly from the consumer lobby, hence the five mentions of the right of the individual user to take. It's elevated these exceptions into almost a right. I mean, it is really a right to be able to parody, to criticise, to review, built in and emphasised very strongly. So we've got if you're a platform, I mean, we're talking obviously YouTube here, that's the main target of this legislation, everyone else gets caught up. Google has to try and produce a system that, on the one hand, makes sure that content that's not licensed does not appear on the platform, which is itself a task, clearly, but at the same time, to allow through an automated gate, any content that falls within the exception. And that seems to me treating the exceptions as if they're a sort of rather binary decision, a binary decision that could be made by some automated system that can say, yes, that's a parody, no, that isn't, yes, that's criticism, no, that isn't, when plainly everything we've heard from the last hour tells us that these are subjective decisions, which are sometimes very difficult for a court to make. And I personally cannot see, nor have I seen anyone offer to me or suggest they have any sort of automated system that is in any way scalable that could make these judgments and therefore comply with the requirement to let through and allow through the accepted content.
Okay, and obviously, so then this is a great concern for Google, obviously, anyone that might be in that position. Let's look at the flip side. Let's look at the US issue.
So
I'm not going to say it's comparable, but it's the flip side.
Yeah, in the U.S.,
Rattle speak to it.
The service providers like YouTube basically have a very broad safe harbor, so they have very little risk of liability for any of the content on their website, with limited exceptions when they have what's called red flag knowledge that something's infringement. But case law has developed that so that's a very high standard to really know that something's infringing and unauthorized. So basically, in the U.S., distribution platforms don't have to concern themselves very much with whether anything posted on their platform is a fair use.
User-generated.
Correct. Instead, it's the content owner's burden to send what's called a takedown notice to YouTube saying, we think this content's infringing. And as part of that notice, they have to say they have a subjective belief that it is an unauthorized use. And a few years ago, there was a decision in the Ninth Circuit in California that determined that content providers actually have an affirmative burden to develop a subjective belief that a use is not fair. And it was all based off this one clip, which we can play. Just
can we play this clip? And I think we're going to be closing. We have 29 seconds left, so we'll end with a baby dancing to Prince. It's just
everyone's
classic.
Favorite. Yeah.
Go ahead, play it. Do I have to move the slide, or are we good?
Well, I think that's the point, really, is that right. That is the video that Universal was the record label here actually sent a takedown notice saying that this clip was infringing. The mother who had posted this video countersued under a provision of the U.S. statute called it's Section 512F, which allows you to send a counter notification saying you believe your use is authorized, and you can actually sue the content owner saying that you submitted a takedown without having conducted a good subjective analysis of whether it's fair use. And the court assessed what Universal did, and really all they had done was looked at how much was used, was the song important to the video. It's important to note this video was actually called Let's Go Crazy, so mm-hmm. that probably played
That's
a role.
A great song.
But there was no analysis of whether it was transformative. There was no analysis of whether it was commercial or non-commercial. There was no analysis of whether there was any market harm. And so the court found without doing that, content owners are at risk of getting sued themselves. So it really flips the burdens onto the content owners to do this analysis early on. And as we've discussed, it's not an easy analysis. So there really is no way of automating it or using a software to analyze things, and that kind of creates these difficult waters to swim in.
These are, I think, burgeoning issues that are going to come up in, I think, in all these jurisdictions, particularly now with the focus on these mass platforms and letting things in or not in, and ultimately, I think what we did with the looking at the fair use analysis from the micro level should give everyone an idea of the complexity. So when we're all looking at it from the macro level going forward and these issues are going to come up, we have a guidepost to understand why they're so complex, these issues. And we're out of time. That's it. Right? Right. Okay. Thank you all very much. And thank this wonderful panel. They did a great job. Bravo, bravo.